Are you ready? Shabbat shalom, everybody. Do we have anything to be thankful for? How about eternal life? Is that something to be thankful for? Well, here we know eternal life comes from the Lord, right? And he is the living Torah, because the Torah are the commandments that come out of his mouth. The Torah is his word, and we know his word always brings life. And so that's why we have this spinning globe here with all these lights, because every one of you are not to hide your light under a bushel. You're going to see in a phenomenal way today how you need to really turn the heat on, turn the lights on, make it brighter so your light shines brighter and brighter. And what's exciting is on every Shabbat, all over the world, Jews and Gentiles come together and they just make this dark world shine brighter than ever. And we know that light is the Torah. And that's what we do here. We really believe in taking the light of the Torah to all the nations of the world. So let's stand and let's open with prayer, committing this day to the Lord. Amen. Together. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kevod Mahuto Leolam Vaed. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Praised be the name of his glorious sovereignty forever and ever. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart, and you shall teach them thoroughly to your children. And you shall speak of them when you sit in your house, when you walk on the road, when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and they shall be for a reminder between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and upon your gates. When the word entered the world, freedom entered it. Its highest teaching is love and kindness. And that is the whole Torah. Go and learn it, honoring one another, doing acts of kindness, making peace. These are our highest duties. Therefore, let us learn in order to teach. She is the tree of life to those who hold fast. All who cling to her find happiness. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. Amen. Together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Let us not enter into testing, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Mode ani lefaneka melekai vikiyam. Shaheka zarta bi nishmati bakemla rabah emunateka. Thankful is what I am before your face, O King, living and eternal, for restoring my soul within me with compassion. Great is your faithfulness. Tell someone Shabbat Shalom. Have a seat. All right. Got a few announcements here. As you know, every Shabbat, right after our second service at 2:30, we have Torah Club here at the offices. Everyone is invited. On Tuesdays, we have a prayer time at 1 p.m. And on Thursdays, we have manna time, another time to study the Torah portions. And then again, can you believe this month is over? It's already December. This year is almost over. But the nice thing, we have our calendar that a lot of people are getting because it's good all the way through to 2026. And we want everyone to get on God's calendar so they know the times and the seasons. We want to remind everybody that the book America at War, you can also get as a digital download. And then there's something else that I want to mention a little bit more here. As you know, we now have, Danny Ben-Gigi and I have been working, we finished the New Testament. I say that in one sense, there's always more we're finding. But the nice thing is when you download it, you always for free get our updates and as we see things. And as he and I have been working on the Torah, we're working on the Torah now, and we are finding so many mistranslations. But we really believe this will be the number one most scholarly, literally translated online Bible for the 21st century, and it is online only. Now, let me give you an example of something that Danny and I discovered just yesterday. Here's Genesis 5, verse 1 and 2. It says, this is the book of the generations of Adam. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God made he him. Male and female created he them, and blessed them, and called their name Adam in the day they were, when they were created. Well, let me show you a little bit better. This is the book, and I cross out the word generations, because that really isn't the best translation. The word in the day is not correct. The name Adam is not correct. In the day when they were created is not correct. Here's a little closer. This is the book of the lineage and history of Adam on the day that God created man. In the likeness of God made he him. Male and female he created them. Blessed them. Called their name not Adam, but mankind. Okay, that's what that is. On the day when they were created. Okay, what day was Adam and Eve created? Rosh Hashanah. This could be translated as this is the book of the lineage and history of Adam on Tishri 1, Rosh Hashanah, when God created man, in the likeness of God made he them, male and female he created them, and blessed them, and called their name mankind on Tishri 1, Rosh Hashanah, when they were created. Okay, see, it's all right there when you correctly translate it. Here it is telling us, but here is more. But wait, get a load of this. When you read this is the book, what does that mean, the book? What book? I mean, Adam didn't have a pencil and paper. Adam didn't create this book. Moses is 2,500 years later. So when he talks about this book, it's as if the book was there during Adam's time because it's listing Adam's lineage. Well, take a look at this. Here's Daniel 7 talking about the return of the Messiah. And it says, I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousands ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and what? On Rosh Hashanah is when the books in heaven are opened. It's not just the wedding of the Messiah. It's not just the crowning of the Messiah. Rosh Hashanah to Yom Kippur, judgment is set in heaven, and on Rosh Hashanah, the books are open. Okay, now, Galatians 4 talks about things being an allegory. There's two covenants. The one from Mount Sinai, which genders toward bondage, is Hagar. And then it says, but Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all, referring to Sarah. And in Psalm 87, 4 through 6, so there's a Jerusalem above and a Jerusalem below. This verse speaks of the Jerusalem above. And it says, this and it will be said of Zion, this and that person was born in her. The highest himself shall establish her. The Lord will count when he writes up the people that this person was born there. This is referring to those who are born again. And so back in Genesis 5, what this is really saying, it was the book of life beginning with Adam. He was writing all the lineage, and then you can be blotted out of the book of life. But I think it's amazing when we look at Genesis 5, and it says, this is the book of the lineage of Adam. It's talking about all of mankind being written in the book of life. And from there, just like Moses' tabernacle was patterned after the one in heaven, this book of Genesis is patterned after the book in heaven. And here it explicitly says it's happening on Rosh Hashanah, which is the day the books are opened. I just thought that was fascinating. Let's stand. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father, our King, we just thank you so much that we can come and worship you. And we pray that as we worship you, the fallow ground of our hard hearts may be broken up even more, that we would be able to have good ground that is going to receive your seed from your word, that it would bring life within each one of us that are here. In Yeshua's name, amen.
For me and my house, we will serve you, Lord, lifting holy hands in worship. We will not bow down to the gods of man. We will worship the God of Israel. You are holy, for you are holy, holy. There is no one else like you. For you are holy, holy. There is no one else like you. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord, lifting holy. Gods of men, we will worship the God of Israel.
the Lord a clap offering. Amen. You may be seated. All right. Are you ready? Buckle up. Give you some quizzes today. Not real hard ones. How old was Abraham when Isaac was born? 100 years old. Now, the Torah portion this morning, as you can see on the screen, is Toldot. And what does Toldot mean? Not exactly. Okay, so let me come here. For some reason, this isn't working, so we'll go like this. Okay, it says generations in everyone's Bible, but that's another correction that Danny and I are making. The Hebrew word for generations is the word dor. All right? What is the difference? I mean, you know, sometimes when you go from one language to another, you don't have a word for it, and you have to kind of, that's why the Amplified Bible tries to amplify things to get a greater meaning. But Toldot is more. It is not just the lineage, but the history. And so just like grandma or grandpa sits down and tells you all about Uncle Bob or whatever it is. So here we have the story of Abraham's going to be dying, Shem's going to be dying, you know, all of the stories. So that's really what generations or what Toldot means. It's not just the lineage and the history, but it's the stories. Or a good word that really isn't a good word is the whereabouts. What happened? So that word Toldot means the whereabouts. Where did they go? What did they do? The history. Now, one of the reasons I bring this up, and many of you are aware of this, when we started in Genesis chapter 2, verse 4, where it says, these are the generations of the heavens and the earth, we had the word Toldot, and these two vavs here, this is the T-O-L-D-O-T. That would be the comparison in the English. But then in Genesis 5:1, it talks about this is the book of the Toldot of Adam, but there's a letter missing. The second vav is missing. And so it would be like that, where the second O is missing. And you don't see these things in English. That's the problem. It's amazing when you see it in Hebrew. Now, in case you didn't know, in the Bible, in every Torah, the word Toldot is spelled wrong another 70 times in the Torah. It's never spelled correct again. So that means something's happened. Well, that letter Vav, what does it mean? What does the letter, every letter in Hebrew is also a word, okay? And so what does the Vav symbolize? Oh, in English, it's the word and. It's a connecting, like a nail connects to boards. The Vav connects two words, this and that. Well, because it's a connection, when God made everything at the beginning, it was perfect. But in Genesis 5, Adam sinned and the connection is broken between heaven and earth. Okay, so now when are we going to see the connection restored? The word Toldot is not spelled correctly again until the book of Ruth, when it talks about the generations of Perez, and he is the one who begets David. It goes through the list, and all of a sudden, when David is introduced, we see the connection to heaven and earth has happened again. Why? Because David is born. And this is why in Matthew chapter 1, when it talks about the Toldot of Yeshua, it begins with the son of David, not Adam, not Noah, not anybody. It's David. Why is it with David? Because the Messiah is going to be the son of David. He's the Messiah. Well, look at this. This is what is so misunderstood by many Christians, because they don't understand the Vav, the connection to the Hebraic roots. in Matthew 1:17, it says all the generations from Abraham to David are how many? 14. From David to the carrying away are how many? And from the carrying away to the Messiah are how many? Okay, we'll get a load of this. Here's the first letters of the Hebrew alphabet. Can anyone tell me what the first one is? Aleph, Bet, Gimel, Dalet, He, and Vav. Every letter in Hebrew also has a numerical value. Like A would be 1, Z would be 26, because there's 26 letters. All right, so these are the first six letters. But notice the D and the V. The way you spell David is a Dalet, a Vav, and a Dalet, which equals 14. So when Matthew is saying 14, 14, 14, someone who knows Hebrew is going to read David, David, David. This whole thing is about proving he is the Messiah, the son of David. Now, let's go to Genesis 25:7, which was from last week's Torah portion. But it said, Abraham lived to be 175 years old. So if Abraham is 175, how old is Isaac when Abraham dies? 75, right? How old is Isaac? Let's take a look here at Genesis 25:19-20. We know Isaac was 75. And now it says, these are not the generations of Isaac, but these are the stories of Isaac, Abraham's son. And we see that Isaac was 40 years old when he got married to Rebekah, who was the sister to Laban. Well, in Genesis 25:26, here Isaac and Rebekah have these two kids. And it says that after that, his brother came out, his hand took hold on Esau's heel, and his name was called Jacob. And then we see that Isaac was 60 years old when Rebekah bore them. Okay, if they got married at 40, they have twins at 60, she was barren 20 years, right? Everyone follow me? Okay, now, how old is Abraham when Jacob and Esau are born? Okay, well, if Isaac was 60, Abraham was 160. Okay, but then what do we find? That Isaac was 75 years old when Abraham died. And so therefore, 75, we see Jacob and Esau were 15 years old. You following me? 15 years old. But you know what is amazing? Shem was still alive for another 35 years after Abraham died. The guy that was on the boat. So get a load of this. Isaac knew Shem for 95 years. Can you imagine? Shem is telling Isaac for 95 years all about the flood, being on the boat, how the whole world was devastated. Well, Jacob and Esau knew Shem for 50 years. Even Jacob and Esau, they got to talk to Shem. They knew about the destruction of the flood firsthand. As a matter of fact, if you look at Genesis 9:28-29, Noah lived after the flood another 350 years, and all the days of Noah were 950 years. That means Abraham knew Noah for 58 years. Abraham knew both Noah and Shem. Now, talk about getting a firsthand view of what happened during the flood. And I think this is one of the reasons why Abraham believed in God. All right? It's not like he just got struck out of the blue. There must be another God. But Abraham got to talk to Noah. And if you look at Genesis 11:10-11, where it talks about the generations or the stories of Shem, we see 2 years after the flood, when Shem was 100 years old, he had Arphaxad. And then it says Shem lived after he begat him another 500 years. Wow, so he lived 500 years after the flood. Now, let's see. Genesis 25, 21 through 23. Here we see Isaac is entreating the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and Rebekah conceived, and here she has these two kids struggling within her, and she says, why is it this way? And so she went to inquire of the Lord. Where did she go to inquire of the Lord? Shem is still alive in Jerusalem. He's the king of Salem, the king of Jerusalem. He's the one who knew about the flood. That's where she goes. And that's where she found out that there were two nations in her body. Now, one of the interesting things that some of you might think this is interesting, it was Rebekah, not Isaac, who received the word concerning God's choice of Jacob over Esau. It was Eve, not Adam, who received the prophecy concerning her seed. It was Sarah, not Abraham, who correctly discerned God's choice of Isaac over Ishmael. It was Miriam, Yeshua's mother, not Joseph, who receives the angelic word first. Just kind of fascinating. Now, in Genesis 25, verse 27 and 28, it talks about Jacob. Oh, yeah. Jacob and Esau are growing. Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field. But Jacob, now one translation says he was a plain man. Another one translation says he was a homely man. Another translation says he was a quiet man. Well, the Hebrew word is tamei, and it means he was truthful. He was a blameless person without blemish. But it says he dwelt in tents, whereas Isaac loved Esau because of how he cooked. The first male chef. Now look at Genesis 25, 31 through 33. Jacob says, sell me this day your birthright. And Esau said, behold, I'm at the point I'm about to die. What profit will this birthright do to me? And Jacob said, swear to me this day. And he swore to him and he sold his birthright to Jacob. All right, there's a lot of interesting things, and I'm going to bring up this chart. If you guys want to take pictures, feel free to take pictures. But this is an Isaac timeline of some things I want to bring out of how old everybody was for a couple hundred years as things go by. But let me point this out in particular. Isaac is 110 when Shem dies. Esau, he has a family because Esau got married at 40 years old. Jacob doesn't have a family. And this is when Esau sells the birthright and they're 50 years old. So at the selling of the birthright, Jacob and Esau are 50 years old. And that is when Shem dies. And the thing about the bread and lentils, that is what they eat at funerals. Forever, Jewish, it was they were having a memorial for the death of Shem, okay? It's the food, okay? The meal of condolence. And look at this. What did they eat? Bread and lentils. It's been forever that way. So when you understand the connection, you realize when he's selling the birthright, it's because Shem has died. Who inherits the birthright from Shem? So this is huge. But the amazing thing is Esau has a family and he doesn't care about passing it on. He just cares about himself. Jacob, who has no kids, sees the importance of the priesthood coming from Melchizedek as well as the kingship. And so Isaac is already 110 years old. But get a load of this. Shem was Isaac's great, 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 great grandpa. And he was still there. In Genesis 14, verse 18 and 19, we hear about Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine. He was a priest of the Most High God. So we see he is both a priest and a king. Now, within Judaism, you can't be both priest and king. Judah is the king, Levite is the priesthood, but in Zechariah, it talks about Messiah coming, and he will again be both priest and king. It's coming back. Now, I believe Jacob also attended the school of Shem. I believe part of his life, he also went to Jerusalem, and he learned from Shem. In Exodus 19:6, we see that all of Israel was to be a kingdom of priests. So here you see kingship and priesthood. But what happens? We had the problem where they didn't want to hear from God. And so Genesis 26:34, we see Esau was 40 years old. And who did he marry? He married two Hittites. The Hittite, the definition means terrorists. He married into terrorist families, two different ones. And it says they were a bitterness of spirit to Isaac and to Rebekah. All right. So let's look at Genesis 26, 1 through 5. Going back, and here we see there was another famine, like the first famine that was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, and the Lord appeared to him and said, "You, I don't want you going down into Egypt. Stay here. I'll be with you. I'll bless you into your seed. And I'm going to give you all these countries." And then look at this. "I will perform the oath which I swore to Abraham your father. I will make your seed to multiply as what?" That's a lot. How many of you can count the stars? And he says, "I will give to your seed all of these countries, and in your seed, all the nations of the earth will be blessed because Abraham obeyed my voice, kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws." Wait a minute. Moses wasn't for 400 more years. So how can you tell me Abraham kept God's commandments and statutes and Torah? Wow. Because Abraham heard God's voice and God told him. Even Adam and Eve kept the Torah. Now, not all of it, but what God, the Torah was from the beginning. That's why the first, what was the first commandment of the Torah? Don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. When we think Torah, we have to think in terms of rules that God gives mankind. And so here, that was the first rule, actually, of God's word. Don't do this. Adam and Eve knew the difference between clean and unclean, even. This is why when Cain and Abel and they did sacrifices, God did not want unclean animals to be sacrificed. Okay, so they always knew a whole lot of the Torah. Okay, so now let's look at Genesis 26, 12 through 15. Isaac sows and he reaps in the same year 100 times what he planted. Can you imagine in a time of famine when everyone's crops aren't doing anything and you're getting 100-fold? You're going to stand out. The Lord blessed him. He grew great. He grew more and more until he became very great. He had possessions of flocks and herds and households. So what happens? The Philistines envy him. Now, you want to see how stupid the Philistines are? I mean, stupid is as stupid does. Here, they're having a famine. And what do you want when there's a famine? You want food, but water. Well, look what they did. All the wells which Abraham's servants had dug in the days of Abraham, his father, the Philistines, stopped them and filled them with dirt. Why would you be so stupid? Why not just take over the wells? Why fill them with dirt? Sometimes envy can drive you to do really stupid things. And just like recently, when Israel left the Gaza Strip in 2005, they had all of these things that they could use. And what did they do? They tore it down and sold the copper, and they ruined everything that they could use to bring in income. All right. And not only that, if there's a famine, you want your livestock to live, and they need water. Why in the world would they fill them up with dirt? Well, so then Genesis 26, 16, and 17, and you have to remember, this is the Abimelech that knew Abraham and Sarah. And he knows that Abraham is a blessed individual. And so he tells Isaac, get out of here, because you're much mightier than us. How stupid. If I had someone that was successful, I would stop and ask them, well, how can we be successful too? Instead of driving them out, I'd say, work with me, help me. It's pride that is what brings a lot of prejudice. So what does Isaac do in Genesis 26, 18? He goes and digs again the wells of water which they had dug in the days of Abraham, because the Philistines, you know, had filled them with dirt after the death of Abraham. And then look at this. He calls their names after the names by which his father called them. He renames them what dad did. Well, guess what? I believe what you guys are doing right now, reinvestigating and digging into the ancient roots, is just much like Isaac's journey going back to the wells of his father. The original sources have been hidden and buried from us, but as Gentiles, we're now digging into the Torah and we're opening up those wells of living water that we're finding right there. And so the Torah is also likened to a well of water, and it also has been hidden from us and filled with dirt. And you guys are doing exactly what Isaac is doing. You're redigging Abraham's wells. You're not trying to dig new wells, which is what replacement theology does. So here in Genesis 48:10, it says the eyes of Israel were dim for aid so that he couldn't see. And he brought them near to him and he kissed them and he embraced them. And so here we see Isaac, his eyes were dim. Well, guess what? Jacob's eyes were also dim. I want to bring this out in Romans 11:25. This is a very important principle. Paul says to the Christians, I would not, brothers, that you would be ignorant of a mystery, lest you be wise in your own conceits, but blindness in part has happened to Israel. Israel is not totally blind. Isaac's eyes were dim, but he wasn't totally blind. And Israel isn't totally blind. It's only happened in part. And we know in 1 Corinthians 3, 13, 12, it says, as Christians, we only see through a glass darkly, okay? And now I know in part. So the Christians see through a glass darkly and know in part. We're partially blind. And the Jews are partially blind. And the first group to humble themselves and look out of both lenses gets to see the whole picture. That's where humility comes in. I mean, when it says the fullness of the Gentiles, that doesn't mean quantity. It means maturity. You don't harvest a crop until it's mature. So God is waiting for the Gentiles to grow up. And so, I mean, a lot of ministries are out there trying to save the lost. El Shaddai is trying to mature those who are saved. So they're not still on milk and cookies. They can graduate to meat and potatoes. Now, a Jew would have to be totally blind to accept a blonde-haired, blue-eyed Messiah who abolishes the Torah and whose followers regularly kill Jews in his name. Hello? Okay. What is more, such a statement ignores Christianity's own blindness to the Messiah. Even though we've possessed the Gospels for 2,000 years, Christians are still largely blind to the fact that Jesus is Jewish, and they don't even know his Hebrew name, Yeshua. Amazing. As a matter of fact, Matthew 7, 22 and 23, it says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we prophesied in your name and in your name cast out devils and in your name done many wonderful works? And he's going to say, I never knew you, you that are doing iniquity. What? How can those things be iniquitous? Well, a lot of it is because they're doing those things for their own glory, not for God's glory. Look at Isaiah 42, 19 through 20. One. It says, who is blind but my servant? Wow. Can you imagine? How would you want to send a messenger 20 miles on a horse to tell somebody something and they were blind? It might take a few days, a few months. Or how would you like to have a servant who is deaf? You know, I mean, this is, and God is saying it's my kids that are blind and deaf. Who is blind as he that is perfect, and blind as the Lord's servant? Now, see, this is going to tie in to the second half that we'll be doing here in a little bit. Seeing many things, but you observe not. Opening the ears, but he hears not. Okay, when you think of seeing many things and observe not, what do you think that means? You can be watching something and then all of a sudden, that's a robbery taking place. Or, I mean, you can see something going on, but this is an easier one. Hearing. Dump the trash. Did you hear me? What you're saying is, if you hear me, you should respond. But sometimes we can see things, but we don't perceive what is really happening. I'll give you another good example of, and I can do this because I'm a man and I'm a husband. You're watching TV, and your wife comes up and says, "Turn that stupid TV off." So you're okay, and you grab the newspaper. Okay, you hear something, but you don't hear the fact, spend time with me. I'm more important than the TV. I'm more important than the newspaper. So, but it happens both ways. You can see things, but not really know what's going on. We can hear things, but not really understand. Does everybody know what I'm talking about? Okay, and so what, if you can't see something, what do you want to do? You want to magnify it, right? You have a magnifying glass. Some people have a whole sheet to lay it on their page to magnify it because they can't see or they can't hear. They get hearing aids. Well, look at the next verse. It says God is going to magnify the law and make it honorable. He wants to magnify. Because we're not seeing, we're not hearing, God wants to magnify the Torah, magnify the sound so we hear him, magnify the letters so we can read it, because the Torah is what is important. Look at Luke 24, 15 and 16. It says, it happened while they talked, this is Yeshua on the road to Emmaus, that Yeshua himself came near and went with them, but it says their eyes were kept from recognizing him. Wow. And this is what Yeshua did. He has kept the Jewish eyes from recognizing him to this day. You can't blame them for not seeing clearly when God has his hands over their eyes. And you're really going to see that. The second half is going to be amazing as we talk about times and seasons. But we have to realize the Christian's job is to pray that God would remove his hand so they can see completely. That's what it's all about. God blinded Isaac's eyes to accomplish his purposes in bringing forth the Messiah through Jacob. Get a load of this. If Isaac had not been blinded, he would plainly have recognized Esau. And the redemption process would have taken a completely different turn. God wanted the Gentiles to be grafted in. And so you have to understand this perspective. If Israel had not been blinded, what would have happened to the redemption of the Gentiles? This is why we have to understand God's hand is in all of this. As a matter of fact, in Genesis 27, 2 through 4, Isaac says, "Behold, I am old. I don't know the day of my death. Therefore, take, I pray you, your weapons, your quiver, your bow, go out to the field, take me some venison, make me savory food such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat and that my soul may bless you before I die. Okay, so here, Isaac thinks he's going to die. He actually lives another 60 years. But he thinks he's going to die, but he's not going to die. But what's amazing, we know Esau is the gourmet chef. All right, we can see here. Go make me some savory food. And yet, many years earlier, he's telling Jacob he wants to eat some of this cheap, poor food, you know, because he's too tired. If he was that hungry, he could have made the food he liked. Now, here's the thing. How old is Jacob and Esau at this time? Okay, now, here comes Jacob pretending to be Esau. At the first time, it was when Shem died, and they were 50 years old. Now, let's go back to this chart. Isaac thinks he's going to die, and Esau and Jacob are 77 years old when this happens. Oh, Isaac lives another 43 years. So Isaac lives another 43 years. I knew it was a little while, but I just wanted you to see this is happening, and they are 77 years old, Jacob and Esau. And what many of you may not have known, when you see this, where am I? Yeah, Jacob is 97 years old when he wrestles the angel. And he succeeded. Pretty amazing. But let's go back here. Okay. What do we find in Genesis 27, 5 through 10? Rebekah heard when Isaac spoke to Esau. Then what does it say? His son. And Esau went to the field to hunt for venison to bring it. And Rebekah spoke unto Jacob. What does it say? Oh, yeah. How you parents know what I mean. When the kid is bad, that's your child. And when they're good, that's my child. And so here we see already this argument. Ah, that's his son. And this is her son over here. And she says, behold, I heard your father speak to Esau, your brother, saying, bring me some great food. And then she said, hearken to my voice according to that which I command you. Go to the flock and fetch me from there two good kids of the goats. I will make them savory food for your father, such as he loves. Bring it to your father that he can eat so he may bless you before his death. Oh, my goodness. Now, Jacob is scared to death because he thinks, one of the amazing things is, I think not only was Isaac, his eyes were dim, but I almost wonder if he had bad hearing, because you would think he could tell after 77 years, Jacob's voice from Esau's voice. But let's look at what happens in Genesis 27, 15. Rebekah took some goodly raiment of her oldest son, which were with her in the house. Can you imagine? Here she's still taking care of Esau's clothes, and he's 77 years old. Okay. And put them on Jacob, her younger son. Now, here's what is something that is quite amazing, and you want to write this down. This event happened on Passover. What's amazing about this, we know Israel did not recognize Yeshua either as the Messiah. And here, Messiah comes in disguise, bringing the blessing to all of mankind on Passover. And in Genesis 27:19, Jacob is speaking to his dad, and he says, I am Esau, your firstborn. I have done according to what you asked me, sit and eat of my venison, that your soul may bless me. And then look here. He came near, and he kissed him, and he smelled the smell of raiment, and he blessed him. And he said, see, the smell of my son is as the smell of a field, which the Lord has blessed. Therefore, may God give you the what? The dew of heaven always refers to the resurrection of the dead. The dew of heaven always refers to the resurrection of the dead. And if you remember, Abraham told Isaac when he was about to kill him that I believe God is going to raise you, Isaac, from the dead. And so here Isaac is passing that blessing on to Jacob. And then it says, not only that, but the fatness of the earth, plenty of corn and wine, let people serve you. Nations bow down to you. Be Lord over your what? Okay, what does that say? How many brothers did he have? He only had one. Or did he have more that's not recorded in the Bible? Think about that. I don't know how many of you ever stopped and look at that. He says to Jacob and Esau, be Lord over your brothers. Well, there's different ways of looking at this. It says, let your mother's what? Sons. Plural. Does that mean there were more sons that they had besides Jacob and Esau? And then it says, let your mother's sons bow down to you. Curse everyone that curses you, and blessed be he that blesses you. Well, what some people say is, in Hebrew, a brother doesn't always mean a literal brother. This could mean their descendants, their Toldot. So I'm not saying there were other brothers or sisters. I'm saying that it looks more like it means all of Esau's descendants, okay? Now, look at this. In Hebrews 11, verse 20. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning what? Things to come. It wasn't for just that time, but for the future. And this is why the do always refers to the resurrection of the dead. Look at Isaiah chapter 26, verse 19. Your dead men shall live, together with my dead body shall they arise, awaken, seeing you that dwell in the dust, for your dew is as the dew of herbs, and the earth shall cast out the dead. All right, so in the Song of Songs, if you remember, when the Messiah is knocking on the door, he said, my locks are filled with dew. Okay, so this is referring again to the resurrection of the dead. And then Esau comes in Genesis. This is 27, verse 32 through 34. And Isaac, his father, said to Esau, who are you? And he says, I am your son, your firstborn Esau. And then Isaac starts trembling very exceedingly. And he said, well, who is this that has taken the venison and brought it to me? And I've eaten of all before you even came, and I blessed him. Yea, and he shall be blessed. And when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with an exceeding great and bitter cry and said to his father, bless me, even me also, O my father. Now remember, he's 77 years old. To me, this is just amazing. And what I think is interesting, you're going to see in the next Torah portion, Jacob also is lifting up his voice and crying. It's going to be payback time. But you're going to find that out next week. So with that, let's stand. And we'll close with prayer. And then we're going to come back and talk again about times and seasons. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father, our King, we just thank you so much that your Torah is so alive. Your word is alive. It's meant for us today, for us to learn from. It's always about things to come, not just the past, but the present and the future as well. Father, give us a heart to perceive and to see those things that are hidden from our eyes. And Father, I just pray right now for all of those that are here in this building and for all of those around the United States and around the world, that the light of your Torah would bring life. Light brings life. That you would bring life. You would strengthen everyone at this time, encourage them. Father, we thank you for any of the tithes or donations that come in, because the sole purpose is to magnify your Torah and to give it the honor that you want it to have. In Yeshua's name, amen. Together, blessed are you, Lord our God, creator and king of the universe. You have blessed us with your Torah of truth. You have blessed us with the whole counsel of your living word by the power of your Holy Spirit through the completed work of Messiah Yeshua. You alone have planted among us life eternal. Blessed are you, Lord our God. Amen. Take a break. If you see someone new, let them go in the line first.